Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to the Azure Seas of Nita. No, wait, this isn't Nita. What am I saying? Of an unknown planet, of course. I am the Heizmeister, and this is the third and last installment of the Cruiser Refit or Rebuild. So, as already announced in the last episode, this time we're gonna focus on finishing up the design, tweaking it a little bit, fine-tuning it, seeing if we can cut the cost of this design a bit. I wanted to get it back closer to the 200,000 material mark, and we will also add more EMP protection, as was strongly suggested in the comments. And yes, that is indeed correct. The EMP protection of this little vessel here is basically non-existent. So, first things first. What needs to be done, other than, of course, applying some paint? Let's begin with trying to reduce the cost of this vessel, material cost. And an immediate measure would be to simply remove the torpedo launchers, or at least reduce them a bit. I have to admit that 8 of those torpedoes, although they are fairly basic, might not be such a great idea for a vessel of this size, cost, and most importantly, tech level. These tech levels I'm talking about will come in pretty... I will explain their purpose in the future, if I haven't already done so. Okay, time to remove one torpedo launcher and add the staggered fire add-on back in. There we go. Now then, all that's left to do is to fill up this hole. And there we have it. Yeah, this is basically done. Now we have made our way towards the 200,000k material... No, wait, 200,000 material mark. Wooden beam to separate both segments, in case anything gets through there. So, now we only have 6 torpedoes. Oh, what a shame. However, there is something I have not installed just yet, and that's basically a missile decoy. The original Tremonia cruiser had a decoy launcher. So, while we have reduced the cost of this vehicle by removing some torpedo launchers, I'm afraid we're going to add to the cost of this vehicle simply by placing a decoy launcher here. Yes, that is... There's probably some comment made here about work and the overall sense of it, or the purpose. So, let's do it like this. Yeah, close enough. Yeah, and you can see we have immediately gained a lot more in terms of material cost. Okay, an IFF. Yes, please. And a control block. Simple ACP that triggers a missile launch whenever there are missiles detected at 2000 meters. Activate those weapon systems. There we go. Yeah, I will set up the actual decoy a little bit later. Now I can still use some wood, a cheap construction material, to close this off here. Please note that's not going to hold off any larger shells. Maybe some spalling from hash or heat. And even then, it has to get incredibly lucky. Okay. Decoy launcher installed. Once again, I will adjust the missile later. So, now then, that wasn't very a cost-saving measure, nor was it. What we can also do is install these 3-meter poles in here. They are fairly cheaper than the actual alloy beams, and the same can be done right here, also adding an additional layer of protection from hash and heat projectiles. So this has been done. Very nice. I could actually do the same thing over here, maybe. Not so sure if this is exactly necessary, since I do have an air gap in there already. However, one can never be too cautious when it comes to armoring up a vessel. At least that's my approach to those kind of issues. You know what? I could make the bulkhead out of poles as well. Let's not do that for now. We have to keep in mind that we still have to place some surge protectors as means of defending against EMP strikes, and those are quite expensive as well. So, all the way with alloy poles. Nah, come on. Some more. There we go. I guess I'll be doing this for quite a while. Boom. I guess this is it then. This is about as much as I could shave off from the initial costs without compromising any armor setups. Yeah, I've not closed in on that magical 200,000k mark just that much. Anyway, now it's time to place some surge protectors. I'm not an expert when it comes to EMP and EMP protection. And so, what I have heard so far is that you should place them, I guess, far away from any components which are susceptible to EMP. The AI, for example, so that the EMP jolt gets redirected to basically here, instead of the AI core, which is right here. And as it travels through materials, I have learned that it can lose strength depending on the material it has traveled through. Please do correct me if I'm terribly wrong there. I'm still not very experienced when it comes to this kind of issue. Okay, well, that's probably all I can do for now. As you can see, the price has increased significantly. We are now at 206,000, and there is not much I can do to lower that cost. In case you're wondering why those things are gone, this is a bug that still persists. There they are, back again. I did not forget to add any barrels. So yeah, I think now it's time to add some paint, and then we will do a few rounds of combat testing. It isn't exactly the same price as the original Tremonia. Where's the original? One moment, it's under Cruiser. There we go. And it should be up there, yeah. About 5k more expensive. But hey, what are 5k anyway? Alright then, painting the boat. After a little while, we can now see that the ship has been fully painted. Yes, I've applied a little bit of paint, and while she might not win any beauty contests, I guess she's going to perform adequately regardless. So, I think we have arrived at this time of the video. It is now time to test the combat capabilities of this fully operational cruiser. But first I would like to change the weather here. Although this is a great opportunity to test the sensor systems, now is not the time. Constant weather. Yes, please. There we go. The fog is lifting and the weather is clearing up. So, let's test this against something it would encounter in any campaign. The first enemy on the field, as you can see it here in the distance, is a Prowler. A deep water guard hard design, I think. Yes. Okay then, here we go. All systems are active and the ship is moving. Now, yep, there we go. The Seabus is also active. Nice. Looks like this anti-aircraft cannon is doing its duty. And torpedoes away. Very nice. Yep, 6 torpedoes deployed and are now on course towards the target. Yeah, speaking about the Seavis, it can only engage targets if the Tremonia cruiser is broadsiding said target. I think that goes without saying. But yeah, let's have a look how things are looking at the other end of the cannon barrel. Not so well, I'm afraid. The rear-facing weapons of the Prowler have been disabled, and it struggles to move forward now. As I can see that the propulsion systems have also been shot off, and it is leaking steam. Yeah. The Tremonia is firing a combination of heat and hash shells. The whole armament of this little cruiser is geared towards disabling frigate to cruiser sized opponents and basically ensuring that the rest of the fleet or any accompanying aircraft can swoop in to destroy the target. Speaking of destroy the target has been destroyed. Yeah, I think this comes to no surprise to anyone. So, let's select a few more targets. Let's put in some aircraft this time. Okay, for the second combat test we have something much more difficult to deal with. The torpedoes won't be of much use here, at least initially, for we have a deep water guard airship, a Moray, on the field, accompanied by 3 flying squirrels. So, let's see how the Tremonia handles this one, and this will also be a great test for the missile decoys. Go! Decoys away. And yes, those are unguided missiles. Well, for the most part. No, it seems to me that they are infrared guided. I've only installed radar decoys on this one. There's something to consider here. Anyway, the Moray is coming under fire by those anti-aircraft cannons. And the Seabus struggling to acquire a target. Meanwhile, the flying squirrels are constantly harassing the Tremonia. It's taking a few shots at one, but probably not hitting it due to the low projectile speed of the main guns. Nicely done. Fire going out in every direction, and we can see that the Moray has now, well, touched down on the surface here of this little body of water and is now being assaulted by torpedoes and the main weaponry of the Tremonia. Moray is down. What about the 3 squirrels? Yeah, what about them? I can see 3 distinct same-looking loot beams over here. I think this also indicates the fate of these flying squirrels. I have not seen what happened to them. I didn't pay any attention to it, so I assume they have been defeated. Clearly they have been. Right, the Chemonia has survived this trial, and now it is time for something much more difficult, which will stretch the capabilities of this little cruiser. Ah, so, you guys remember this one, don't you? The Jormungand, an old Onyx Watchship I repurposed for, well, the current version. And yeah, it is significantly more expensive than the Tremonia. It also has a wide arrangement of rather scary guns, most notably those cramp cannons and the APS gun, the large caliber APS gun here in the back. Alright then, let's see how the Tremonia handles this opponent. No, I don't want to make a screenshot, thank you. Yeah, I need to maybe fine-tune those weapons so that doesn't shoot herself, and oh, the first cramp salvo missed. Good job there, Jormungand. And we are on course towards the target. Yeah, not very advantageous here to simply point at the enemy. Your Sievers is mounted on your stern. Alright, there we go. We have now closed into brawling range and all weapons are opening up. Nice cram cannon shots intercepted. And we can see that this large APS gun is ripping chunks out of the Tremonia's armor. And she is suffering. How does the Jormungand look? Well, it has suffered as well. To be more precise, it has suffered a catastrophic detonation of its only high-caliber APS armament. And that doesn't look very good. Where are you going? Well, while the torpedoes are going places, let's see how the Jormungand is doing so far. It has run itself aground. Yeah, I guess that's what you get when you are performing combat trials in an area with shallow water. But anyway, let's see if the Tremonia runs herself aground as well. And then we can conclude this round of combat trials with the result that I may need to work on those. Yep. There we go. I guess it's only fair that both ships have run themselves aground. And yeah. There's not much to say here, I guess. Okay, how's it looking over here? Looks like the Jormungand's weaponry has been disabled, save for one cramp cannon turret. Those. Now, I would like to have an explanation to why these torpedoes are suddenly deciding to become airborne and it exploded. Ah, yeah. It probably bounced off the seafloor or something. Anyway, before I bore you all with the sight of the Jormungand being defeated, it is now probably. Yep, it is very much disabled. The Tremonia has served her purpose, and I would give the victory in this case to the Tremonia. So, that means the last opponent the Tremonia will be facing is probably the most interesting one. The last battle will decide if the retrofit or refit has been worth it. Will the Tremonia be able to defeat, will the new Tremonia be able to defeat her original counterpart? For the purpose of this next and probably final combat trial, we have sat down in a region of this map where there are no shallow waters around. At least not so shallow that you would run a ship aground. Anyway, oh, shots are being fired already. We have this time The original, the old Thremonia cruiser facing the refurbished and rebuilt one. So, let the battle begin. There we go, shots out already. Very dangerous opponent facing here. Both opponents have their main weaponry, or the majority of their main weaponry, facing forwards. Torpedoes striking the old Thremonia and doing some damage, as you can see here. Oh, and there's that way too large caliber Sievis doing some work. Oh, torpedoes out from the old Thremonia. They are going for decoy, apparently. Yep, please bear in mind that I do not have any signal processors on the torpedoes of the new Thremonia here. And the old one has decoys as well. But yeah, there you see, it went for a decoy. Have the guns fallen silent now? Why is nothing happening? Oh, there we go. Yep, the Sievis is also targeting torpedoes. I mean, if it's capable of doing so, why not let it do this? Oh, I think we might see an anti-aircraft cannon going up in smoke anytime soon if this barrage keeps up, but no, apparently not. Currently, the shots from the new Thremonia are only striking the upper deck of the old one and have disabled one of the forward guns. Okay, but no major explosions just yet. What about the old one? The new one. Yeah. Well, she's still in the fight. Still active and firing. Now focusing her fire on the forward turret. Oh, thank you for proving me wrong there. The rear turret of the old Thremonia. And okay, looks like she has successfully disabled the rear Sievis. It's not firing. Strange. Well, I think at this point we can fairly say that we can say with certainty that the new Thremonia is coming out on top in this fight here. Although she hasn't directly destroyed any of her opponent's weaponry, I wanted to say. Yep. Not only did she destroy her opponent's weaponry, no, she also destroyed FTD. Great success. Great success indeed. No, wait, we're back. We're back. I take it back. She's still going. There is the main weapon in pieces now. And the relentless heat and hash barrage continues to strike the old Thremonia. Torpedoes once again meeting each other halfway. Interceptors going out. And yeah. There goes the second main gun, and I think this is it for the old Thremonia. Well, once this is over, we have to do one more official task, which is to save this old version of the Thremonia in the museum and replace the existing blueprint with the new one. Yeah. But hey, at least we have learned something. We have improved the ABS Tetris, at least, well, I have learned a lot. And yeah, quite happy with this little cruiser. Though it does cost me quite a lot, at considering this is supposed to be a Tech 1 cruiser. And the price is a little bit on the higher side, but then again, the performance, I guess, can justify this. May need to work on her broadside routine a little bit. and not yet something I'm very satisfied with, and I need to work on the firing angle restrictions of the rear turret. But after that's done, yeah, she's finished. So, is there anything left on the old Tremonia? Doesn't look like it, to be honest. So I'd say I'll call this battle here. The new Tremonia cruiser has won. I'm happy. Okay, the old Tremonia blueprint has been relegated to the museum and archived. So, now it is time to do the official duty. Replace the existing one. Yes, please. There we go. Ah, now it is official and the Tremonia has been replaced. Now, yeah, I will probably continue to add some cosmetic changes and off camera, most notably to the bridge probably and around the deck here. But this is something that I'm not going to concern myself with just yet. Anyway, I hope you have enjoyed this series of refitting a old design to new standards, and I guess I'll see you next time on the mysterious seas of this mysterious planet. Take care and goodbye.